Thank you. So I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to give this talk here in this very nice workshop. So we'll be talking about Definity CRM. So Omar mentioned these things a little bit in his conclusion as a useful tool in quantum information theory, in particular when you want to analyze the security of some quantum key distribution protocols. And what I will be talking about is Definity CRMs when you deal with infinite dimensional systems. Okay, so this is the outline of the talk. We'll first start by giving some overview of many Definity CRMs that exist, both classical and quantum. Then, because I want to talk about infinite dimensional systems, I will talk about the representation of the unitary group and some Fock spaces. And then I will ask which density matrices are unitarily invariant for representation of the unitary group that I will define. And then at the end, I will talk about some application. And one of the applications, the main application for this, is to prove the security of some continuous variable quantum key distribution protocol. But here, I will talk about random matrices and what happens when you truncate them. Okay, so. It's not working. Okay, sorry for that. So let me first talk a little bit about Definity CRMs. So there's a long history of those. I will only be talking about finite versions. So what this kind of theorems tell you is that, okay, so first I will talk about classical version due to Diaconis and Friedman in 1980. So the idea is that you look at a distribution of n random variables, x1 to xn. Each xi is on some set S. And you look at distributions which are permutation invariant. Okay, so if you permute the variables, it doesn't change the value of the probability. And now you ask, okay, if you have a permutation invariant distribution like this, and you consider the k marginals, the marginal pk, which is the law of the first k random variables, and then you ask, what does this law look like? Turns out that it basically looks like an IID probability distribution. Okay, so more formally or more explicitly, if you look at this marginal pk, you can approximate it very well by some IID distribution. So p is the distribution for one variable. You just take the case product of this thing, and there exists a measure on distributions on S, such that this total variation distance between pk and this mixture of IID distributions is close to zero. So it's given by this. It's superbounded by basically the size of the set S times k over n. Okay, so if k is small compared to n, this is small. Okay, so how do you prove such a thing? Well, basically, this comes from the total variation distance between the hypergeometric and the multinomial distributions. Why is that? Because if you have a permutation invariant distribution like this, basically it's a mixture of hypergeometric distributions. So one way to think about this is to consider that you have a bag with n balls, and each ball is colored with one of S colors, and you want to pick k balls in this bag. So you have two ways to do that. You can do it without replacement, or you can do it with replacement. If you do it without replacement, then your random variable is kind of characterized by a hypergeometric distribution. And if you do it with replacement, then you have a multinomial distribution. And as long as k is small compared to n, as long as you don't pick too many balls, basically you won't see a difference between these two distributions. And so you can bound that, and you can get a bound like this. Okay, so this is a very nice theorem. And then, so it was like almost 40 years ago, and much more recently, this kind of theorem has appeared in quantum information theory. First, due to Kevs, Fuchs, and Schack, but more recently, Christendahl, Koenig, Michelson, and Renner, they proved the finite version of a quantum Definity theorem. So now the setting is almost the same, You just replace your probability distribution by a permutation invariant density operator, okay, that acts on n qubits. Okay, and you say that your state is permutation invariant if it is invariant under the application of any permutation. So the here this pi is just a representation of the permutation group that basically just permutes the factors of your space. Okay, and now if you have a state like this, which is permutation invariant, what you can show is that it's closed if you take its marginal, so if you trace out n minus k subsystems, so you just keep k subsystems, then it's closed to a mixture of IID quantum states. Okay. Damn it. So it does not like my slides. Okay, ça a planté encore. I'll take my computer maybe. Okay, so sorry about that. Okay, so you have this quantum version of the definitely theorem. So it's just the generalization of the classical theorem because it implies it. And it's useful in quantum information theory because it can be used to prove the security of some quantum cryptographic protocols or to like study the tomography of quantum states. So it's very useful. But somehow it's limited to qubits, okay, to finite dimensional systems. But okay, so there's no reason why you should be limited to consider finite states or finite dimensional systems. And indeed, you can look at generalization of these definite theorems that hold for arbitrary sets. So for instance, Diaconis and Friedman in 87, they considered a slightly different setting. So now you have a distribution of x1, xn, and these variables, they are real variables. And you just look at permutation invariant distributions, but now you look at orthogonally invariant distributions. So what does that mean? It means that if you take any rotation or any orthogonal transformation in On, you ask that the distribution is invariant when you apply R to your vector. Okay, so this is the definition of an orthogonally invariant distribution. And then when you have that, you can ask the same question. You can look at the marginal pk. Okay, I'm not lucky. which is the law of x1 to xk. And now, what you can show is that in addition to being close to AID, it's actually close to being a mixture of Gaussian variables. Okay, so this p sigma is just a Gaussian variable with zero mean and the variance sigma square. And now, so when you have a distribution which is orthogonally invariant, you can show that if you look at the marginal pk, it's close to a mixture of Gaussian variables. Okay, and somehow the error term is the same as before. It's basically n by k. Okay? So one example of this is, for instance, you take a random vector on a sphere. So you look at a d-dimensional sphere, and you take a random vector with a uniform distribution. And you just look at the k first coordinate of this thing. Then it will be close. Each of these coordinates will be close to Gaussian variables, IID. And actually, this kind of results hold for different symmetries. You are not restricted to orthogonal invariants on Rn, but you can look at positive variables or integers, for instance. And just the same way as before, there's a way to make this quantum, to look at a quantum version of this kind of theorem. And in the old paper, years ago, we kind of did a baby version, which is a quantum version of this, where now the state is an n-mod quantum state, which is invariant under the action of any passive interferometer. So a passive interferometer on n-mod is described by a unitary in un, and somehow asking that this is invariant under this action is asking that your state is invariant under some representation of the unitary group, un. And then what we could prove is that if this is the case, and you take a look at the marginal of rho n when you just keep k modes, then it will be close to a mixture of IID Gaussian state now, which are actually thermal states. This is kind of nice, but it's very easy, and it's not very useful. But actually, the motivation for this work is to try to improve this thing, because a much stronger statement of this could be used to prove the security of continuous variable quantum key distribution. So this is what I will try to explain in the rest of the talk. Okay, so how can we even further generalize these kind of ideas? Well, let's look at random variables, which are not just vectors anymore, but matrices. Okay, so now I'm looking at variables x and y, which are just two random matrices. X is a C by P complex random matrix, and y is a N by Q complex matrix. And now that I will say that the distribution on x and y is unitarily invariant if it's invariant when you apply a unitary U on x, U in UN, and the complex conjugate unitary, so U bar to y. Okay, so this is my what I ask now. I want to look at distributions like this. And as before, I'm looking at a marginal of this thing, so I'm looking at the distribution for the first k rows of x and y. And I'm asking, okay, what can we say about this distribution? What can we say about this distribution? And really, this kind of question is closely related to the study of the truncation of random R matrices. So what is that? So first, what you can do is to take a random unitary matrix U according to the R measure on UN, okay, and you just output the upper left submatrix UKK of U, so just the first K rows and first K columns, and you renormalize to get something which is of variance 1. So this is a first, your first distribution, HKK, which is defined like this. And you want to kind of say something about this distribution. In fact, it will be close to a different distribution, which is a distribution over K by K complex matrices, where each entry is just a random normal variable complex. Okay, so this one is called GK times K. And so there are a few results like this. So in quantum information theory, people who have looked at that, or Aronson and Arkhipov, they have studied something which is called boson sampling, which is very fashionable now in quantum information science. And in their paper, they proved that these two distributions, so this one, which is the truncation of a random R matrix, and the Gaussian one, they are closed in total variation distance, and they have this bound, which is K6 over N for the total variation distance. So we know that it's not tight, and actually the right scaling has been given by Jiang and Ma this year, and it shows that the right scaling should be K squared by N. So in this paper, Jiang and Ma, they don't give an explicit upper bound for this thing, but they just prove that when K is smaller than square root of N, it converges to zero. And in this work, I will prove a less good bound. I will prove this bound, so K cube divided by N. So it's less good than this, but it's explicit. And actually, this is just a corollary of a quantum definite theorem. Okay, so we have a quantum approach to prove this thing. Okay, so now let me talk a little bit about Fock spaces and how to and representations of the unitary group on Fock spaces. So what is a Fock space? So if you start with a finite dimensional Hilbert space H, you construct the Fock space F of H as the direct sum of the symmetric subspaces of H. So sim k of H is just the symmetric part of HK. So for instance, if H is just a Q-dit space, so CD, then F of CD, this Fock space, which is known in quantum optics, for instance, as a Fock space with n modes. So an orthonormal basis for this space is given like this. It's given by T-uples with D coordinates, K1, K2, up to KD, where each of these values take integers values. So this is an orthonormal basis for the Fock space. To each mode, we associate an annihilation and a creation operator that satisfies this commutation rule. And any state on this Fock space can be expressed as functions of creation operators applied to the vacuum. So if you look at any element of the basis, K1, K2, up to KD, can be written as the operator, the creation operator applied K1 times for mode A1, up to the creation operators for mode D applied KD times on the vacuum state. Okay. And in this talk, I will look at two Fock spaces. This one, FPQ1, so it's just the Fock space of CP plus CQ. And I will look at the Fock space corresponding to n copies of that one. So FPQN, which is just n copies of FPQ1, or alternatively, it's the Fock space of CNP, so matrices of n rows and p columns, plus CNQ. Okay, so this thing is a Fock space with n times p plus q modes. Okay. Turns out that there's a very convenient representation for Fock spaces, which has been given by Segal and Bergman, which is to view this space, F, this Fock space, as a space of holomorphic functions. So any state in this space, psi, will be represented by a holomorphic function with n times p plus q variables. Okay. And the norm that we put on this space is this. It's basically the integral of the norm of this thing, psi of xy squared, multiplied by a Gaussian density. So let me give you some examples of this thing. How do we get from a state in this representation to a holomorphic function? Well, basically, you just represent your state as a function of the creation operators applied in a vacuum. And basically, you take these creation operators as formal variables. And this gives you your holomorphic function. So for instance, the usual Glauber coherent state, alpha, this is the output of this laser pointer, can be written as this, can be written as the exponential of the annihilation operator. Well, there's an alpha missing here. E to the alpha A dagger applied to zero. And the function that represents this state in this Segal-Bergman representation is just e to the alpha x. Another example of a bipartite integral state, which is a two-mode squeeze vacuum state, which can be written like this. So if you write it as a function of the creation operators on two modes, A and B, it will be written like that, as the exponential of lambda A dagger, B dagger applied to the vacuum. And so the holomorphic function it corresponds to is this one. It's e to the lambda xy. And if you have n two-mode squeeze states, basically you have this function, e to the lambda x1, y1, plus x2, y2, plus xn, yn. And this is your function. OK, so now that we have this Fock space, let's show that you can have a representation of the unitary group on this space. So I want to have the unitary group un to act on this space. How does it do that? Simply, basically, by a change of variable. So for any unitary u in un, I define the representation w u of psi to be just a new function psi of u x and u bar y. Okay. So this defines the representation of u n on the Fock space mathematically. And physically, if you have a state here like this, phi that lives in this Fock space, you have n times p plus q modes. So we have basically p blocks here of n modes and q blocks of n modes here. Basically, the unitary group acts on this space by applying an interferometer on these n-modes here, and the same one here, and the same one here. All these interferometers, they are defined, or they are characterized by U, and you apply the conjugate, the complex conjugate interferometers on the Y part of the state. Okay, so now you have the representation of the unitary group on the Fock space, and I want to understand which states are invariant under this action. So first, there's a kind of a nice lemma that was already proven in this paper by Christendahl, Koenig, Michison, and Renner in the case of permutation invariance, which tells you that basically, if you want to consider density operators that are permutation invariant, actually it's sufficient to restrict your attention to pure states. So this is what it says. So if you have any state rho which is permutation invariant, I mean, any density matrix which is permutation invariant, then there exists a purification of the state of rho, a purification psi of rho, that lives in a space h to the n times k to the n, where h and k they are isomorphic, such that this new state, psi, is permutation invariant. So do you prove that? Basically, you just construct this state, psi. So you start with the maximally entangled state on your two spaces. So this is the maximally entangled state, sum of ii tensor n. And you just define psi to be 1 times the square root of rho applied to this state. And now because rho is permutation invariant, you have that square root of rho is also permutation invariant. And because phi is permutation invariant, you have that psi is permutation invariant. And you can check that if you track the partial trace of psi, you recover rho. So what this tells you is that it's sufficient to consider pure states. So you just want to understand what is the how to characterize states which are invariant under any permutation in the permutation group. So the this defines what is called the symmetric subspace of your space. And actually, the same will hold in the case of the unitarily invariant density matrices. So if you have a unitarily invariant density matrix, then there exists a purification on a larger space, which is of your state, unitarily invariant. And the proof goes exactly in the same way. You have to be a little bit careful because the maximally integral state doesn't really belong to the Fock space. So you have to take the right limits to get this, but you can do it. And so what this says is that it's sufficient to consider the case of pure states. Okay, so now what I want to do now is to kind of understand what are the states psi which are invariant under the action of the unitary group. Okay, or which are the holomorphic functions psi of x, y, which are invariant when you do psi of u x and u bar y. Okay, so before I do that, let me just say a few words about the usual permutation invariance. Case. So we define the symmetric subspace of CD to the n as a space of states which are invariant under any permutations. And actually, this space is very nice. It's spanned by IID states, which are like psi tensor n. So this is the simplest that you can hope for. And this psi tensor n, actually, they correspond to what is called SUD coherent state, generalized coherent states. Okay, so these are generalized coherent states. We'll talk about that. And what is nice also, and what is useful for applications, is that this space is very small. The dimension of the symmetric subspace is only polynomial in n, instead of exponential in n. So similarly, now we can define a symmetric subspace for this unitary invariance. So it's all the states in the Fock space that are invariant under W of U for any unitary group, or in UN. And what I prove in this paper is that this symmetric subspace now is spanned again by generalized coherent states, which are not defined for the group SUD anymore, but for the group SUP, Q. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about this generalized coherent state. So there's a general construction due to Perelomov in the 70s that basically defines generalized coherent sets for any Lie group. Okay, so if you start with a Lie group G, so for instance SUD, and you have a representation of this group on H tensor N, for instance, in the case of SUD, this group is, acts on CD tensor N like this by just applying U on every factor of the space. So you have this. You need a distinguished vector, psi 0, so for instance, 0 tensor N. And then your generalized G coherent states are given by basically applying this. This representation to your distinguished vector. Okay, so psi sub j is just t sub j applied to psi zero for any j in the group, t in the group. So for instance, for SUD coherent states, your coherent states are just like this. They're just u tensor n applied to zero tensor n. And the coherent states, they are labeled by elements of this factor space, G sub G by H. So H is just a stationary subgroup. So these are the states which are just changed by the phase when you apply TG. And so in the case of SUD, this vector space is just the unit sphere in CD. Okay. So the SUD coherent states, they're just basically labeled by a point of the sphere. So now I want to talk about the Fock space generalization. So we have this SUPQ coherent states. So just before I define them, let me show you one function which is clearly one form, which so a quadratic form which is invariant under the application under the unitary group, which is this one, just the sum of k from 1 to n. X ki y sub kj. So this is invariant when you apply this transformation. So when x is mapped to u times x and y is mapped to u bar times y, and it's very easy to check. Just write it down, and you have this u dagger u that appears. And this is because u is unitary. U dagger u is just the identity. So this quadratic form is invariant under this change of variables. In particular, it means that any state written like this is also unitarily invariant. So if you take a P times Q matrix, complex matrix lambda, you can define a state which is just the exponential of lambda 1 1 z 1 1 plus lambda 1 2 z 1 2, etc., plus lambda pq z pq. So if you want this state to be normalizable, you need that to impose that the spectral norm of lambda is less than 1. But as soon as you have this satisfied, then this state clearly belongs to the symmetric subspace. It's invariant under this change of variables. Okay, so let me tell you what is SUPQ. It's just the set of matrices of P plus Q and times P plus Q matrices, complex matrices, which leave this form invariant, which leave this matrix invariant, and that has determinant 1. And so it turns out that this set of matrices acts on these lambdas here, like this. Okay, so you have lambda, you can map it to this thing for any A, B, C, D that belongs to SUPQ. And if you have this, you still keep a matrix which has spectral norm less than 1. So this is basically are this group SUPQ acts on a symmetric subspace. You can show that the stationary group is just this. And you can just apply Perelomov's construction. So you get a factor space T by H, which is just a set of P times Q matrices with spectral norm less than 1. So this will be the labels of your coherent states. And so the generalized coherent states, phi lambda n, is just associated to a matrix lambda. And what is very nice is that this phi lambda n is an IID Gaussian state. So it can be written as phi lambda 1 tensor n. And so it's IID, and it's a Gaussian state because it's an exponential of a quadratic form in the creation operators. So it's a very nice state. So one of the nice things when you have a family of coherent states, basically their defining property is that they resolve the identity. Okay, so these are my coherent states, generalized coherent states associated with matrix lambda. So if I integrate over the set of matrices with spectral norm less than 1, with the right measure, with the invariant measure on the set, then I recover the identity on the symmetric subspace. So this is very nice because this is basically the property that helps you to prove definite theorems. Okay, and once you have this, so you can prove a definite theorem, so a Gaussian definite theorem that is stated here. So basically it says that if you have a state, psi, which is unitary invariant, so that belongs to this symmetric subspace, then if you trace out k times p plus q modes, so basically think of the of k rows in your matrices, then when you get out, what you get out, this state, is close to a mixture of IID Gaussian state, to a mixture of these generalized coherent states. And the error term is quite good. It's basically the same as what we had in the finite dimensional case. So it turns out that kind of this theorem can be seen as a special case of a result by Koenig and Michison. And the proof, you can get the proof for this thing and kind of easily by adapting the proof of the initial definite theorem for permutation invariance. So it basically relies on two ingredients, the resolution of the identity that I gave before, and just this inequality. So this Ck and Cn plus k, they are here. They are this constant that appear in the definition of the invariant measure on your set. Okay, so now I have this Gaussian definite theorem. And what I want to do, so one thing it can be used for is to prove the security of quantum key distribution with continuous variables. A different application that maybe is more appropriate here is for considering the truncation of random R matrices. So this is the problem I was mentioning at the beginning of my talk, where you have these two distributions, H and G. So let me remind you. So G is just k by k random matrix, where each entry is IID and a normal variable with variance 1. And this HKK is just obtained by first taking unitary with the R measure on UN and just keeping the top left part of the matrix. So the first K rows and the first K columns. And you just renormalize.
Is it coat of K or coat of N?
Sorry?
Because is the factor of coat of K here?
I think it's
because you start from nothing, which is of
right. Yeah, so root of n. Yes. N. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Thanks. Okay. So now, what I just want to say is that this kind of thing can be proven as a simple corollary of the Gaussian definite theorem that I had before. So, what's the idea for this? To prove this, The idea is basically to find a quantum state that yields a distribution which is close to this one, to the Hermitian and the unitary group. And then we'll look at a k-marginal that yields this distribution. And we'll use the Gaussian definity theorem to argue that it's close to what you get when you consider a Gaussian state. So let me detail this a little bit more. So we start with defining this state, so this function, exponential of alpha x11 plus alpha x22 plus alpha xkk. So in quantum optics terms, it's just a product of standard coherent states. But if you, what you can do is, so for instance, you can measure this state with what is called heterodyne detection, or you can look at the Ousimi function of this state. And if you renormalize this thing, you get a distribution that it will be picked around this vector. Okay, so if you measure this thing, and alpha is very large, you will get basically a vector, so you will get a matrix that will be very close to this matrix, to E1 up to EK. So E1 is just a vector with a 1 in the first coordinate and zeros everywhere else, and K is a vector with just 1 in the kth coordinate. So you start with this kind of pure state, and in order to get the unitary invariance, basically what you do is you twirl the state, so you do twirling. So basically you define a new state which is obtained by just taking rho alpha 1 and applying all possible unitaries, and you take the sum of this, the mixture of this. So when you do this, you get a state which is unitarily invariant by construction, which is kind of what you want, because so now if you trace out k rows or modes, it will yield a new state, and if you measure this state with heterodyne detection, or if you look at the Ousimi function of this state, basically by construction, it will approximate this distribution, hkk, because you start with a distribution which is close to unitary to a random unitary, and you just look at the marginal, so you get this. But at the same time, you can purify the state, and if you purify the state, now you have a pure state that lives in this symmetric subspace, and you can apply the Gaussian definity theorems of before with p and q equal to k. And if you do this, so you need to, so I won't prove it exactly here, I just give kind of the intuition. If you take the limit where alpha tends to infinity, and if you renormalize, when you measure rho 2, you will get this distribution that is arbitrarily close to hkk. And if you apply the definity theorem, it tells you that your state is close to a mixture of Gaussian state. So the only missing element that you need to prove is that the mixture totally reduces to a Dirac distribution, which is true in the limit where alpha tends to infinity. And then if you have only a Dirac distribution, the Ousimi function of your Gaussian state, of your mixture, becomes exactly Gaussian IID variables. Okay, and so this is how you prove the result. Okay, so now I just want to conclude. So I just want to say that definite theorems, they are very ubiquitous in this quantum information theory. They are very useful as soon as you have you study quantum state, which are permutation invariant. But usually these theorems, they fail when the dimension, the local dimension of the system becomes infinite. It was the same for in Omar Stoke. The entropic accumulation and the usual techniques for definity, they only hold when the local dimension is finite. But sometimes, so for some problems in infinite dimension, you have a stronger invariance than just permutation invariance. You also have permutation under, for instance, the unitary group, un. And this is the case, for instance, when you look at quantum cryptography with continuous variables. And in that case, this kind of theorem is very useful. So the open questions, can we find other applications for this kind of ideas? And one thing that I find very intriguing, but I don't have, I don't know how to address because I don't have the right mathematical background, but so in quantum information theory, in many other places, I guess, you have this very useful Schur-Weil duality between these two groups, I mean, between GLD and the permutation group that both act on this space. And in this work, somehow you have a related kind of duality, much weaker than Schur-Weil duality, but you have a duality between SU, P, Q, and UN. So you replace the permutation group by the unitary group, and you replace this unitary group of dimension D by this generalized unitary group. Can we extend this kind of comparison between these two kind of dualities? I mean, what does this duality, I mean, can it be helpful somewhere else? Can we better understand this duality? I don't know. Okay, and with that, I would like to thank you.